Welcome back on Dynamo. Today I want to propose you a series of video about the Battoton Legends of Nagash. Each video will be a centralized analysis of a theme about the Battoton itself. This is done in the way that you can go to hear what you want to follow about a specific theme that I treat. Moreover, I want to remember you that a part about the common battle traits and the common abilities that are about four of the analysis that are inside this battle tome, I realized a video specific one, a focus that you can find up here on the right, and you can go to see that one. And I decided to divide it in the way that if you want to hear about two parts, you have a focus that treat it completely focused on it. Otherwise, you'd have a risk to hear in each analysis talking about the same thing repeatedly. So I decided to cut that part and put in a specific video focused on it. So now we can begin. And about the units in the Legion of Blood analysis, we can find that only the units that are inside this battletome, the battletome of the Legends of Nagash, can be used with these aliases. So there are not such a problem about these four grand aliases that are new inside this battletome. Moreover, we have another must that is in the case that we want to add a Mortark. A Mortark has to be a Neferata. So before we are able to take another Mortark as a model for this army, we have to put Neferata as the general of the army itself. Moreover, we have another interesting thing to see, that is, if Nagash is inside this army, it's not a must to have it as the general of the army itself. And if it will be in the case that you have another Mortark, so Neferata in this case, Neferata will be the general, instead Nagash will be another model of the army itself. And talking about the magic for the Legion of Blood, the wizards of the Legends of Blood analysis must have an additional spell that comes from the Lords of the Dead, and these lords are two: the Lord of the Death Mages and the Lord of Vampires. About these two lords of spells, I'll talk in another video, because otherwise the video itself will become really too long, so I'll talk it in another video. The first characteristic battle trait about the Legends of Blood analysis is Immortal Majesty, that let you subtract 1 to the bravery characteristic of enemy units within 6 inches of any friendly Legion of Blood units. And it's quite interesting, because you have to remember that inside this battletome, a lot of units with their own standards give another -1 to the opponent bravery. So it comes to have a -2 bravery penalty. And if you think that in this case you can influence also the battle shock of the opponent's unit, it's come quite interesting. Anyway, it's also true that a lot of units and a lot of armies has the option to ignore totally the battle shock penalties and even the test for the battle shock. So you have to take note about it. But it's also true that when it works, if you moreover consider that you have the spells, the ability of other units to combine and so on, you can have quite a lot of penalty that can be worth this battle trait. And the second characteristic battle trait of these aliases is Favored Retainers, that let you add 1 to the attack characteristic of all melee weapons used by friendly units of the Legion of Blood Blood Knights and the Legion of Blood with the keywords of the Vampire Lord. And it's quite interesting, because in the case that we have Vampire Lords being a keyword, it means that you can also be referring to Vampire Lords on Zombie Dragon. And this being a battle trait, it goes to influence also the attacks of the Zombie Dragon itself, so adding quite a lot of attacks to the unit. And also for the Blood Knights of this Alliance, Legion of Blood, it lets you add the attacks also to the mounts of the Blood Knights themselves, so improving quite a lot the amount of attacks that such units can bring. So it's quite interesting. And now we can talk about the command trees. First of everything, we have to talk about one thing to remember, that is the command trait can be given only to the non-name characters, so the characters with a name can't have a command trait. These aliases require one more thing than the normal general ones, because normally the general doesn't have to be a hero, but to play these aliases, the general has to be also then a leader, also a hero. So you have to take note about this detail when you choose these aliases for yourself. And another thing to remember is that you can both choose or throw randomly to choose the command trait for your army. Sincerely, I don't value the option about the random. I prefer to choose the command trait because it's one of the main part or how to make the army works. So I sincerely don't even consider the about of the randomly throwing the dice to choose the command trait. And the first command trait is Swift Strikes, that say that each time that you make a hit roll of 6 plus in the combat phase for this general, you can make one additional hit roll for the same weapons against the same target. And this is also a limit of this command trait, because for example doesn't work on model like the Vampire Lord on Zombie Dragon, because only the Vampire Lord will have the attacks and not the Zombie Dragon, that is the part of the model that can have the mass part of the attacks increased. So this is quite a problem in this way. But there is also a nice thing if you think that you have the option of the Coven Throne, for example, because I want to remember you that the Coven Throne itself is not a mount, because the attacks that are brought from the Coven Throne model, it's from the vampires and from the host of spirits, so they are not from the mount itself. In this case, so unless there is a fuck by the Games Workshop, for now the Coven Throne can be quite be good influenced by this command trait. The second command trait is Soul Crushing Contempt, that say that if the general slays any model in the combat phase, subtract one from the bravery characteristic of the slain model unit until the end of the turn. So talking about this command trait, we have also to remember the battle trait Immortal Majesty that will bring this malus to a minus 2, and this is without considering the presence in the nearby of unit that has a standard and also other units like the Morghast. So even if there are a lot of armies that are immune to the test of Battleshock, this trait can be quite useful if you think that you can have in the units that doesn't have such a disadvantage for this command trait a malus of minus 2 or even minus 3 or even more if you are able to use this in a good way, so that you can have quite a great decrease in the Battleshock test for the bravery characteristic. The third command trait is Aristocracy of Blood, that let you reroll failed charge rolls for friendly Soul Blight keywords unit that are within 9 inch of the general at the start of the charge phase. This is a command trait that works quite good with relationship with stopper units of sublight keyword like the bat swarms that being summonable ones can use the grave sides to enter in the game or simply with the blood knights to use them as charge units, so it's a nice thing to use in this way with the sublight keywords unit. The fourth command trait is Aura of Dark Majesty that let you subtract one from the hit rolls of attacks that targets this general in the combat phase. This is simply a good command trait. Moreover, if you consider that it's not vinculated to the range of the weapon that goes to target the model itself. So it works till it's done as attacks in the close combat phase. It's quite interesting one, this one. The fifth command trait instead is Walking Death. That say that if the hit roll for an attack made with one of the genus melee weapon is 6 plus, do not roll to wound. Instead, the target suffer a number of mortal wound equal to the damage characteristic of that weapon. This is a really good command trait for the models that has a great amount of attacks and moreover the ones that has a great value of damage for each attack. Moreover, if you remember that if the general has the keyword vampire, goes the battle trait favored retainers, it has also an additional one attack for each of its melee weapons. Anyway, you have also to remember that this command trait doesn't apply again with zombie dragons, for example. So you have also to remember such a thing. For the contrary, anyway, you have also to remember that you have some models like the Coven Throne that can do a great use of such command trait, because you have yet the Spirit Host that has the mortal wounds, but you have both the Vampire Queen and the Maidens that will be able to have such great command trait available. So you have to pay an attention to this thing. The sixth command trait is Sanguine Blur, that let you add 2 to the general move characteristic. In addition, you can reroll failed charge rolls for this general. So it's a really good command trait if you want to bring easily and fast the general in the close combat with other enemy units. Analyzing in the general the command traits that we talked about, we have a lot of different ways to use the command traits in a useful way. In this Alnisis Legends of Blood in particular, the command traits are for the most part used to increase the power of the general itself, so you have to remember to value these command traits in the way that you have best suit for your army and your preference to play. And now we can start talking about the artifacts, remembering that you have the access to these artifacts only for one hero of your Legion of Blood, so not available for your allies in this army. The first artifact is Ring of Dominion, that say that when the bearer is selected to fight in the close combat phase, you can pick an enemy model within 3 inches from the bearer and roll a dice. On a 5 plus, you can pick a melee weapon that the model, enemy model, is armed with, but not one that is having a value or one or more characteristic for that attack that is given with an asterisk or C below. For this combat phase, the bearer of these artifacts may attack with that weapon in addition to their own. So this is a really interesting artifact, but you have also to remember that this is only on a 5 plus activation. But this is also true that it becomes quite interesting if you use this artifact in combination with the command trait Walking Death for your general, in the way to improve the number of attack that the general itself has. So it's quite a great combination to use in this case. The second artifact is Shade Glass Decanter, that say that after armies has been set up but before the first battle round has started, select an enemy hero in your hero phase. As long the hero is on the battlefield, you can roll a dice. If the result is higher than the number of the current battle round, that hero suffers one mortal wound. It's not quite solid as an artifact, because it depends quite a lot from your flow and the turn that you have. So more the game is continuing, less this artifact can be useful. But it is true that it lets you to select a hero and be independent from the distance that that hero has from you. And moreover, it can also damage it greatly to arrive killing it, or to damage it in the way that it loses some function during the game, so it becomes quite interesting. The third artifact is Orb of Enchantment. This lets you once per battle, at the start of the combat phase, pick an enemy hero within 3 inches from the build, and in that combat phase, that enemy hero may not pile in, attack, or use abilities. This, even if è only one used to have as artifact, being quite a great artifact, cause it grants you an advantage against enemy hero, so that it can also arrive to be killed without the option to be responding to your attack, so even make the opponent lose one of his chooses to attack. And so using your hero with this artifact or a unit that has charged and is doing combat against this hero itself to kill it before that he can do something, so it becomes quite an interesting one to use. You have quite a lot to pay attention to the possibilities that this artifact gives you. The fourth artifact is Soulbound Garments. This lets you reroll save rolls of 1 for the bearer. This is a good artifact, that is a good defensive one, but at the same time it becomes quite not so good because it's limited not to the failed saves but only to the ones. So it's a good one but not the best, simply. The fifth artifact is Oubliette Arcana. That say that when an enemy wizard successfully casts a spell within 30 inch of the bearer, instead of attempting to unbind it, you can declare that the Oubliette Arcana will attempt to capture the magic energies. Roll a die, and if you obtain a 6+, the spell is negating and has no effect. In addition, that spell may not be cast again by that wizard for the rest of the battle. This is a really randomly artifact to use, but at the same time it's quite interesting to take note about, because you renounce two options to unbind this spell. In this case, maybe it will be quite a discussion if it's vinculated to the amount of times that you can unbind, but I think that it's not, because you renounce to the option to unbind to use this artifact, so I don't think that it's in a limit way of usages. But if the randomly use can be quite a decrease in the options, you have also to note that if it works, it lets you gain quite a lot, cause it lets you uncast the spell, the casting of the enemy model, and moreover make lose that spell itself, so it becomes really quite interesting and can delete some unique spells of the enemy army. So it's quite an interesting artifact, even considering the really few possibility that this artifact can work, but it becomes quite an interesting one. The sixth artifact is Amulet of Screams, that lets you once per battle, when an enemy wizard successfully casts a spell, instead of attempting to unbind it, declare to use this amulet, and on a 2+ on a die, negate the spell itself that has no effect. So, contrary to the one artifact before this one, the fifth one, you can have to remember that it's quite more solid to use, but it's not a certain anyway. But at the same time, if the other one, the Oubliette Arcana, was a multi-use artifact, this is a one-time artifact. So if you use this artifact, you have to remember that you have to choose quite carefully the moment you use such unbinding, such artifact. Talking about the artifacts, at the end you have only to choose which one to use, because you have the option to choose the ones that are suiting better for your army and for yourself. And it depends quite a lot on how you want to use. And moreover, you have to remember that it's quite important in this case if you want to use a Warscroll battalion to improve the amount of artifacts used, because one or two artifacts can be quite interesting in this case for these artifacts to use in your army. About the different strategies that you can use in this agency, I suggest you to see another video that I'll bring successively, because otherwise this video will become quite long and it's not the case. From Dynamod it's everything. I invite you to put a like on this video, to subscribe to the channel, to ring the bell, and to comment this video if you are interested in something about this video or you want to suggest me some arguments for other videos. I hope to see you again to the next time.